Do you have a personal favorite mantra? I do, and it's really simple. It's only three words. Follow your heart. So it's one that I have used to make decisions for decades, actually, and it has led me down some paths that have caused my mother to say, big heart, little brain. More than once, by the way. I actually have followed my heart into orphanages around the world where my husband and I adopted children. I followed my heart and became a midwife. I followed my heart and into refugee camps. And I've even followed my heart back to school when I was already a grandmother. Now, I'm sure you've heard it too. Follow your heart. Pursue your passions. Live your dreams. Only do work you love. And I think that's great. And you should follow your heart, but protect it too. Because what those little sayings don't tell you is sometimes following your heart will first light you up and then burn you out. Now, burnout comes with a plethora of nasty side effects: mental, physical, emotional exhaustion, depression, anger, cynicism. And perhaps most concerning of all, is it can rob us of the ability to care. So the typical advice for overcoming burnout goes something like this: work fewer hours, take more time off, take a sabbatical, don't work nights and weekends, or even quit. And while that may be good advice for somebody who has a 9-to-5 job and an understanding boss, what about all those people for whom there is no off-ramp? For example, have you ever started your own business? Do you know somebody who has? Entrepreneurship can be really rewarding, and it is really demanding. And the idea that an entrepreneur could take a sabbatical and still keep their dream alive, well, they just don't go together, do they? Volunteers burn out too. It might be a humanitarian aid volunteer seeing extreme poverty for the first time, or the 10th, or the 100th. It might be a church missionary who's burning out from the heavy demands of religious service. And when volunteers burn out, they usually don't go back. Those organizations and the people that they served are left without the people who could have helped them. And then there's the ultimate life path with no off-ramp: parenting. Hello, I love kids. I love babies. I love toddlers. I love preschoolers. In fact, I love all the ages and stages. I just don't love all the parts of all the ages and stages. So I don't know about you, but getting up every hour and a half at night, being thrown up on, or worse, toddler tantrums, teens who talk back, they're not high on my list of passion projects. And even more than quote-unquote normal parenting, those parents of kids with special needs have an even greater propensity to burn out. And sometimes they can't even find a two-hour off-ramp because they can't find or afford the specialized babysitter that their child needs. Well, in 1988, my husband and I entered that world of special needs parenting when our second daughter was born with significant disabilities. It was a world we did not anticipate and we knew nothing about. But we got our feet underneath us, or so we thought. And by 1991, we had had another child and adopted two little girls from Romania, as well as the fashion of the day, thank you very much. Those two little girls both had disabilities, and while we loved that first year with them, it was fun and it was rewarding and it was amazing and it was really, really hard. And in fact, I don't remember most days that year. But I do remember one day really clearly. It was October and I was standing at the kitchen sink and I was crying. We had just finished another boring meal in a string of boring meals. And I started to look forward for some reason on how many meals lay ahead of me. Let's see, 3 meals a day, 365 days a year for, I don't know, 30 years. Well, that's when I started to cry because the number is 32,850. Now, I get that 32,850 is a big number. But the fact that I was crying over something so normal as eating, I mean, hello, we all do it, should have been my clue that I was already into burnout. Well, quitting parenting was not an option. So I set out to discover what would help me first survive and then thrive. What would allow me to follow my heart but protect it too? What would give me the bandwidth to meet the heavy demands of my growing family, but also be able to serve my community and later the international community? I've come to believe that that answer is deep self-care. As I've researched and implemented and researched some more, I've actually come to divide self-care into two categories, deep self-care and surface self-care. Surface self-care are those checklist items that make us feel good in the now, but they don't give us the lasting emotional benefits of deep self-care. For example, a good Netflix binge after a stressful semester might be just the thing. And while I personally love pedicures, I have not been able to find any research looking at their emotional benefits. And I've tried. The reality is, I can go months without a professional pedicure, but I really can't go very long at all without the core practices of deep self-care. The good news is, there are a number of ways that we can each practice deep self-care. I'd like to talk about four today. The first is gratitude. Gratitude literally changes our brains. It releases the feel-good hormones of dopamine, serotonin, and oxytocin, but it also rewires synapses and allows us to see the world around us in a better light, a more hopeful light. Gratitude increases our immune system. It, of course, makes us happier, but it also helps create tighter connections to the people around us. Now, when I was deep into burnout, I had a hard time finding things to be grateful for, so I started small. I'm grateful for sunshine. I'm also grateful for air conditioning. I'm grateful no one set the house on fire. Until the day in May 2005, when I couldn't say that anymore. And then I was grateful that no one was hurt when the house was on fire. Now, after years of trying to practice gratitude, I am still grateful for air conditioning. But I can also say that I am truly grateful for some of the harder things. I'm grateful for lessons learned through grief and pain. I also find that when I am feeling down or out of sorts, that almost certainly I've moved away from the practice of gratitude. Going back to it shows me that there's always something to be grateful for. And writing it down helps me put that right in concrete form in front of my face for that moment, but also for years to come. That actually brings me to my second point, journaling. Journaling for healing and growth was first researched by Dr. James Pennebaker, and he and subsequent researchers found that if people would focus on the meaning-making of difficult and even traumatic events, that they could have a positive emotional experience around that experience, around that trauma, even to the point of post-traumatic growth. Now, I used to think that journaling meant I had to sit down for an hour or two every day and just pour the contents of my brain onto paper, and I did not have time for that. But I read a book one time that suggested that people journal by putting a time frame on it, a short time frame, even as short as 5 minutes. That was life-changing for me. I have now been a consistent journaler for years, not daily, but consistent. And you can be too, because in 5 minutes, you can do a gratitude list, you can write in bullet points, you might be able to create a haiku, or use a writing prompt to help spur something, right? I also have found that journaling kind of lets those things that just bubble around below the surface come to the surface and can be seen as a form of mindfulness, which conveniently leads me to my third practice. Mindfulness and meditation. Mindfulness is the practice of being able to be aware of our emotions and our environment without being overwhelmed by them. And meditation is the practice of being still, of turning inward and quieting our minds. Now, I get that asking somebody who's burned out to sit in stillness and quiet their minds can be really hard. But there is power in mindfulness and meditation, and there is loads of research to back it up. I think it's one of the most important things we can do in our lives to provide that deep self-care for us. Finally, there's mindset. You may not have heard of Carol Dweck, but you almost certainly have heard of her work on fixed and growth mindsets. A fixed mindset is just what it sounds like. We believe that our talents, our ability, our intelligence, they all come as a concrete package. But a growth mindset suggests that we're not going to stay the same, that we have the ability to learn and to grow and to improve. Now, there's some really fascinating research out of Harvard in 2013, and the researchers surveyed 19,000 people, and they asked them two questions. How much growth did you experience in the last decade? And how much do you think you will experience in the coming decade? And what was so interesting is that everybody that they surveyed, from teenagers to retirees and everybody in between, they all pretty much said, yeah, I think I'm good. I think I've arrived. They did not anticipate that they would have a lot of growth in the next decade, while looking backwards and saying, oh yeah, lots of change, lots of growth in the previous decade. What that really means for all of us is that we will not be the same people a decade from now as we are today. And the good news is we have the ability to help decide the kind of people we want to become. In fact, a lot of times what happens is we overestimate what we can get done in a day or a week, but we underestimate what we can do in a year or 5 or 10. If you take 10 minutes a day times 365 days, that's 60 hours in a year that you can spend on mindfulness or gratitude or on personal development, 600 hours in a decade. So, I know the question you might be asking. All right, Holly, how on earth are we supposed to add deep self-care into an already full life? Well, the good news is you do what works for you. So the first time that I ever heard about a morning power hour, I about fell over laughing. You mean there are people who take a whole hour in the morning for themselves? That did not work for me. But what did work was a power minute, and then a power 10 minutes, and sometimes it's even a power half an hour. And it's not always in the morning. Sometimes it's in the afternoon, sometimes it's in the evening before I go to bed. You can journal in a variety of ways also. You don't have to always write by hand. You can type in the computer. You can speak into a voice recorder. I use a mindfulness app on my phone to remind me every day to be consistent. And I love reading, but I couldn't find the time to do the kind of reading that I wanted until I discovered that I can listen to books. Now, I listen to books and podcasts while I drive, and that has allowed me to consume, to read, over 100 books a year for the last several years. Being vigilant about guarding my emotional health has allowed me to be the mother of 25 children. Big heart, little brain. Okay. It has also allowed me to go back to school. And at age 51, I earned a bachelor's degree. And at age 53, a master's degree. And now at age 55, I'm a second year PhD student. Thank you. This deep emotional self-care has given me the bandwidth to be able to go into refugee camps, to work with people in trauma at home and abroad, to be able to mourn with those who mourn and sit with those who are suffering, because I have not been sucked dry of my ability to care. Far more than a trendy hashtag, the practices of deep self-care give us the resilience and the ability to do the work we are on earth to do. The world needs your gifts, but you cannot give them if you're burned out. So yes, please follow your heart, but protect it too. Thank you.